Harper Wave and Harper Audio present Energy Medicine, The Science and Mystery of Healing by Jill Blakeway. This is the author. Alex Taberi was a healer and a scholar. He was my first teacher, and this book is dedicated to his memory. Introduction. In the 1840s, puerperal fever, or childbed fever, a postpartum bacterial uterine infection, swept through one of two maternity clinics at the Vienna General Hospital in Austria. At the first clinic, the mortality rate among women giving birth was 10%. In the other, it was less than 4%. The two clinics admitted patients on alternate days. When women learned they'd gone into labor on a day reserved for the clinic rife with childbed fever, they'd often drop to their knees begging not to be admitted. Some women went so far as to stall long enough to give birth outside. These women, who'd given street births, as this practice came to be known, remained eligible for childcare benefits, even without having to be admitted to the clinic. And, as it was later discovered, they also rarely contracted the childbed fever that was raging inside. Ignaz Semmelweis, a Hungarian doctor who'd recently begun working at the first clinic, wondered what protected these women from such a highly contagious infection. After all, both clinics used almost all of the same techniques. The only difference? Medical students worked in the first clinic, whereas midwives worked in the second. After a meticulous process of elimination, Semmelweis concluded that he and the medical students carried cadaverous particles on their hands, whereas the midwives, who did not perform autopsies and had no contact with corpses, kept their hands free of such contamination. As for the women who'd had street births, they'd managed to avoid infection by not having medical oversight during childbirth at all. Semmelweis subsequently ordered that doctors at the first clinic wash their hands with chlorinated lime water after performing autopsies and before examining patients. After the practice was instituted, the mortality rate at the first clinic dropped by an astounding 90%. Semmelweis then ordered the midwives at the second clinic to do the same, in addition to scrubbing their instruments in a chlorine solution. Again, this dramatically reduced the hospital's death rate. Yet, despite clear evidence that Semmelweis's theory and practice saved lives, his colleagues, clinging to their well-established beliefs, refused to concede that these results were anything more than coincidence. After all, they couldn't see the cause of death, the microscopic bacteria, and more important, Semmelweis's data didn't correspond with how they believed the body operated. The germ theory of disease had not yet been accepted in Vienna. Diseases were attributed at that time to a variety of different and unrelated causes. Semmelweis's colleagues ridiculed him and eventually stopped following his guidelines. Soon after, Semmelweis lost his job. He spent the rest of his life fighting the medical community on this issue of sterilization and cleanliness. And at age 47, this innovative thinker was committed to a mental asylum where he died from sepsis. The foundations of energy medicine are as ancient as history. In Egypt, a description of the laying on of hands as a prompt to the body to relieve pain was found in the Abers papyrus, one of the oldest preserved medical documents, dated 1550 BC. Pythagoras, the Greek philosopher and physician, considered healing his greatest calling and considered the pneuma, literally meaning breath, to be the spirit. In Ayurveda, a health system developed thousands of years ago in India, the life-giving force is referred to as prana. In Judeo-Christian belief systems, it's called the breath of life. And in traditional Chinese medicine, TCM, which is what I've practiced for 20 years, the animating force that plays an essential role in maintaining and restoring health is called qi. In this way, spirituality, philosophy, and science were once intertwined, making up an essential part of our history. But we have since strayed considerably from this notion. I often wonder if one day we'll look back on energy healing and shake our heads in disbelief, as we do with the story of Semmelweis, wondering why any of us resisted an approach that offers such benefits simply because it didn't fit into our prevailing medical model. And yet I admit, I myself took my time in coming around to this view. My career began with an instinct to help others. It was as broad and naive as that. But as my work took form, after studying East Asian medicine in graduate school, I practiced acupuncture in hospice before starting my own practice in New York City, I came to recognize the profoundly interwoven nature of healing. From the start, in my work as an acupuncturist, I was both humbled and intrigued by the way patients thrived under my care. It bolstered my faith that this ancient practice, administering thin needles to affect the flow of energy within the body, offered such effective results. It also, however, raised a number of startling questions. Most essentially, why was it that this manipulation of energy was so beneficial? Was I simply acting as a placebo? Or was I some kind of conduit, as I sometimes curiously felt, with energy coming through me when I worked? Chinese philosophy posits that a vital energy, what is called qi, surrounds and courses through our bodies to support life. It holds the body's innate intelligence, the intangible yet measurable way we maintain what's known as homeostasis, or the body's ability to regulate its internal environment to create good health. But qi is also understood to be part of a larger pattern, a grand energy field, through which we are all interrelated. As I became more adept at my work, I had the sense that something I couldn't see was influencing what was happening. Not unlike, perhaps, the intuition Dr. Semmelweis felt in his clinic. I suspected that the needles and herbs which I prescribed to supplement the acupuncture were only part of what was helping my patients. And increasingly, I felt an undeniable sensation when I practiced. Physically, it felt as if someone were pouring tonic water down my spine. Mentally, it came across as an acute instinct that I was drawing energy from outside and channeling it for my patients. I was captivated by this notion, but I was also afraid of it, impatient with it, wary of its validity. I was conscious of and self-conscious about the energy healing field being rife with, to put a fine point on it, quackery. While TCM practitioners like me are licensed and held to a specific standard both medically and ethically, there are no minimum standards for most other types of energy work, which makes this a precarious landscape to enter with fellow practitioners who can hang a shingle and ask clients to simply have faith in what they do. The last thing I wanted to give people, including myself, was false hope. I never want to overpromise or underdeliver. My policy, I should also say, has always been to recommend and in some instances require that my patients confer with the appropriate medical doctors in conjunction with my treatments. But I also had the strong impulse to further explore this ancient medical system that sought to unify the physical and the energetic and to understand it within the worlds of science and spirituality and philosophy today. As someone who methodically charts her own progress, I wasn't able to just accept that an enigmatic mix of needles and invisible energy fields served my patients so well. I wanted to know why. I also, fervently, wanted to explain me to me. So I pursued a variety of knowledgeable and dynamic specialists, healers, academics, doctors, scientists, and researchers on the cutting edge of energy medicine, and I found that they were all working from remarkably and reassuringly similar and interconnecting theories. Moving from the scientific to the mystical and back again, this book has been both a deeply personal project and a professional inquiry. It's as important for me to take an unflinching look at what I may be experiencing as a healer as it is to measure the changes that arise from energy interventions and to validate them with evidence-based research. As such, over the last few years, I've studied the research of the former Dean of Engineering at Princeton University, Robert Jahn, co-founder of the Princeton Engineering Anomalies Research Pair Lab, which developed its own experimental agenda for investigating collective consciousness and its effects on us. I was counseled on spirituality and healing by Neil Donald Walsh, the best-selling author of the series Conversations with God. In Japan, I visited the healer Hiroyuki Abe, who applies energy to acupuncture points without using needles. I asked a psychophysiologist to measure what happens in my body when I'm working with a patient, published research on energy medicine in the Journal of Alternative and Complementary Medicine, and consulted a British MD with an interesting take on how the acupuncture meridians work. I also spent time with William Bengston, PhD, author of The Energy Cure, Unraveling the Mystery of Hands-on Healing, who is both a healer and a scientist. Dr. Bengston trained a team of skeptical colleagues to use hands-on healing with lab mice who'd been given injections that induced mammary cancer. The result? Dr. Bengston and his teams cured the mice time and again in every experiment. This book is an account of what I've come to know about the most dependable and impressive means of harnessing healing energy, and how we can all make this powerful force work for us. I hope that listeners will not only come away with an understanding of what healing energy is, but genuinely trust it and feel encouraged to explore their own needs in a more informed way. And as I believe everyone has an innate ability to tap into healing energy within themselves and in the world around them, I've included exercises throughout the book to help listeners draw on their own capacities. While Chinese medicine will always be my foundation and focus, the work I do now is very different from when I first began my career. It's the result of various disciplines that span many cultures and belief systems. And as I'd hoped, my patients are better for it. More unexpectedly, however, this search has allowed me an unwavering faith that what cannot be explained, the bit of mystery that will always lie just out of reach, may be attuned to our needs. 1. At my fingertips. The first acupuncture patient I ever worked with on my own was a woman who'd broken both of her legs. She'd visited a fire station with her women's group and had been encouraged, ill-advisedly as it turned out, to slide down the fire pole. When I met her, she was still walking with two canes, a full year after her accident. I was just beginning my third year of a four-year master's degree in acupuncture and Chinese medicine in San Diego, California, and a long way from my native Britain. Before treating this woman, I'd only ever performed acupuncture on a patient as an assistant to a more senior student. Before that, I'd practiced on sewn bags of rice. This was my first day working as an acupuncturist and herbalist in the school's clinic. And though I did have a supervisor, he was also watching a number of other students, all of us practicing acupuncture unaccompanied for the first time. In the treatment room, the woman looked at me expectantly and handed over a set of x-rays from her doctor. I held them up to the light and tried to at least appear confident as I attempted to decipher what exactly I was viewing. At that moment, my supervisor popped his head around the door to check on me. He strode across the room to turn the x-rays right side up in my hands. "Just do a basic treatment," he told me quietly. I forged ahead. I asked the woman to put on a gown and lie down on the small table. When she was ready, I dutifully began putting needles in a selection of basic acupuncture points to address her pain. The woman was completely still and silent throughout. Honestly, I had no sense as to whether anything I was doing was having any effect at all. The session seemed rather unremarkable, disappointingly so, until the end. What happened next will sound too good to be true, but bear with me. The point of this story is that it's easy to attribute recoveries we don't understand to the miraculous when, in fact, they're really just recoveries we don't understand. After I'd removed the last needle and whispered a quiet thank you to indicate the treatment was over, the woman opened her eyes and said, "That felt amazing." She sat upright from the table and declared, "I'm going to try to walk without my canes." And that she did. She walked slowly around the room. I felt as if I were on a daytime talk show. The whole thing felt so surreal.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.